352,000. That is the number of Toastmasters that we have. I did a rough calculation. About 15,000 to 20,000 of them are district officers or international officers. They can't contest. So that leaves 330,000 people who are eligible to contest. The number of people who contest is 30,000. Congratulations if you've decided to take part in the international speech contest. Because you are already among the top 10% of Toastmasters. And that in itself is a big achievement. If you're going to contest, be happy that you're already among the top 10%. Good morning, my name is Rupinder and this is about getting it right. I know that this presentation is not in the right mode. That is because I wanted to tell you that there is this nifty little number here. It is slide 1 of 47. There are 47 slides that I'm trying to cover in the next 35 minutes or so. And now, let's get it right. So my first question is, why? Why do you want to participate in the International Speech Contest? Why? I want reasons.
To realize the full potential.
To realize your full potential. What else?
Contests are very encouraging.
Contests are encouraging. The one thing that we miss about contests, and especially in Toastmasters, Toastmasters contests, is that we treat them like contests. We go out there, we try to impress people. There are some people who are very enterprising, they try to impress the judges. But a Toastmasters contest is the exact opposite. It is about expressing yourself. And this is the point that most people most often miss out in a Toastmasters speech contest, be it humorous, be it evaluation, be it table topics, be it even the international speech contest. So what do you speak about? Fundamental question, what do you want to speak about?
Something that intrigues me.
Something that intrigues you?
Yes.
How many of you are from a sales or a marketing background? Ever been in sales, marketing, business development?
Business development.
So there is this fundamental principle of marketing. You put yourself in your
customer's shoes.
Who's your customer when you're delivering a speech?
Audience.
Put yourself in that audience's speech, audience's shoes. What is it that you want them to do in the first place? What is it that you want them to do? Trust me, 99% of speeches, they miss out on this very important aspect. What is it that you want your audience to do? And I will come back to this later. But first, do we make it sensational? Does a sensational speech work? Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. The answer is no. It's not about making it sensational. Don't get any wrong ideas. Keep it simple and sincere. Speeches that win are speeches that are sincere. A lot of people have asked me what a lot of people indulge in drama, a lot of people indulge in histrionics on stage, a lot of people try to bring additional props and they try to sing on stage. There was a contestant who was throwing out chocolates in the semifinals in Chicago. Again, don't try to make it sensational, keep it sincere. Everybody knows this?
Yes.
Opening, body, yes. Conclusion?
Yes.
Everyone knows this? There is also a very important part, and it resonates throughout your opening body conclusion. A message. Your speech needs to have a message. Remember, what is it that you want the audience to do in the beginning? Again, it's the message. The message. And most of the time, 99% of the time, we miss out on the message. We either start with one message, towards the end we are at another message. We totally miss out the message. Which is why speeches need to have a specific and a generic purpose. A generic purpose could be to inform, to inspire, to persuade, to request, to require. But then there is a specific purpose. That specific purpose is, what is it that you want the audience to do? What is the message that you are trying to convey? Which is why I say that if you don't have an opening, a body, a conclusion, and a message, you don't have a speech. Go back and write another speech. You might have a stand-up comedy act, but you don't have a speech. Stand-up comedy acts probably will not have messages. They don't have message. How many messages should your speech have in a 5 to 7 minute speech?
One.
And many people try to give multiple messages, and that is where a lot of people fail. So what do you start with? The first thing is your
opening.
We just covered it.
Speech.
You start with your message. You start with your message. And this is where it gets difficult. People do not start with message. You start with your opening. And you spend so much time on the opening, you want to get the opening perfect to such a level, you miss out on the message. By the time your speech comes around, you've got an opening, but you don't have a message. And that is where your speech is doomed to fail. Then you build the
structure.
Opening, body, or conclusion.
Okay.
Which one?
Body.
Body.
Excellent. You build the body. Body will contain what?
Anecdotes.
And?
Stories.
And?
Message.
And?
Examples.
Examples. Now, I wrote down stories, anecdotes, experiences, incidents, thoughts, opinions. You added examples. It can have non-examples. It should have the message, like she pointed out. The body will contain all of these. Once you've got the body, you add the opening and the conclusion. So short and sweet, you start with the message, build the body, add the opening and the conclusion. This is one of the most celebrated principles in instructional design, in training development, when you're writing training content, when you're delivering a sales pitch, when you're delivering a presentation, when you're giving a speech, when you are trying to express yourself. It's called ARCS. How many of you have heard of it? It stands for attention, relevance, confusion. Oops, once again. Attention, relevance, confidence, satisfaction. Attention, relevance, confidence, satisfaction. Your speech, your sales pitch, your presentation, your performance starts by gathering the attention, by capturing the attention. Second stage is establishing relevance. Where lies the most fundamental principle of learning and development? Adults will learn only when they find it relevant. So you have to establish the WIIFM. Which is, what's in it for me? Then you build confidence. This is where your stories and your examples and your non-examples and your incidents, they will start taking effect. And last but not least is the satisfaction. And satisfaction comes from your closing. Attention comes from your opening. Relevance and confidence come from your body. Relevance can also be there in your open. So attention, relevance, confidence, satisfaction. How many of you have heard of this part? Ethos, logos, pathos.
Uh-huh.
Ethos, logos, and pathos.
Aristotle principle.
Aristotle brought out these principles. And this is 2000 years of learning here. Ethos is the integrity that you bring to your communication. Logos is the logic, and pathos is the passion. Successful speeches have more than 60% passion. You look at Steve Jobs, you look at our Prime Minister, pure passion. Successful speeches have more than 60% passion. All TED Talks, more than 60% passion. Your speech typically will be an inspirational one, passion, more than 60% pathos or passion. Integrity, logic, passion, as I said. What was that again? If you understand, the human attention span is limited. It is limited to 2 minutes when you are listening to someone else, which is why you need to incorporate questions, anecdotes. You need to have voice modulation,
humor,
some sort of a distraction or some sort of a reinforcement every 2 minutes. Now, in a 2 minute speech, in a 5 to 7 minute speech, ideally you would have 3 reinforcements. I would say that keep it to around 6 to 10. So that is the number of times your message gets repeated or gets reinforced inside your speech. How are you saying it? Now, this has got nothing to do with grammar, by the way. The point is, how are they listening to you? A lot of us have done courses in active listening. One of the most fundamental principles of active listening is that you don't listen through your ears. You listen with your eyes. You listen with your other senses. Those of us who have been in the dramatics field, in drama, first, when you read about a Shakespeare drama, you try to imagine what it is like. Then you watch it on television, you understand it better. When you act in it, you understand it in its entirety. In the first instance, there was only one sense that was involved, that is sight. Second instance, it was sight and sound. In the third instance, it was sight, sound and feeling. Your speech should be such that people involve all the three senses. They should be able to listen to you through their ears. They should be able to follow you with their eyes. They should be able to enact your feelings by verbal or non-verbal agreement or disagreement. For example, in my speech, why me? By the second time, people were themselves saying why me. And there was a point where I did not have to say why me, although I did. But there was a time where I did not have to say why me, because the audience was doing it for me. That is feeling. This is where eye contact becomes very important. This is where you need to maintain eye contact so that people can listen to you with their eyes. What is your measure of success? It was told to me by a world champion. He said, what if you were to step off the stage and die, what would you want the world to remember you for? I had just won a division contest that day. I had no intention of dying.
What the audience benefited?
So, your measure is, what do you want them to do after your speech is over? This is your measure. What do they take back home? What do they remember you for? Which is why your message should be simple. This is why me. Is this readable?
No.
Is this readable?
Yes.
So we have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 parts. We have how many parts to my speech?
10.
10 parts. What do you think this is? Shiva, you don't answer. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. What do you think this is?
This is a numeric pad for the calculator.
I'm right now standing at position number 2. To my left is the position number 1. To my right is the position number 3. Or to my right is position number 1 and to my left is position number 3.
Yes.
This is how I divide my stage. 9 squares. Now, why is this important and why did we go through my 10 different parts of my speech? Because for each part, when I was practicing, I decided on the position, the expression, the action, and the transition. So my speech was going to start in square 2, I would move to square 1, square 3, come back to square 1. My first story was happening in square 7, second story in square 8, third story in square 9. Squares 4, 5, 6 were for continuing my respective stories. Finally, I would come back to 2, go back to 8, and then close standing at position number 2. But for each part, each of those 10 parts, I knew exactly what I was going to do, where I was going to do it, how I was going to do it, and how I was going to move to the next part. So for example, in the beginning of the speech, I did not point to position number 3. But when I was about to tell a story, I pointed to position number 7. Why? Because later on in my story, I was going to reinforce that part. So I pointed to that part of the stage. So how do you make it work? You divide and conquer, just like I showed you. Okay? See, the point is, and I'll have to go back. The point is, you will not be able to do position, actions, expressions, and transitions for a 5 to 7 minute speech. But if you break it down in parts, then each part is at least 1 minute in length, and that is more manageable. And I did, once I did 10 parts, once I decided that there were going to be 10 parts, the way I practiced was day 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Day 2, 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Day 3, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Until it was such, I came to such a point where I was able to simply recall a part, know where I was going to stand, and enact it from there. I had internalized the speech to that extent. Now, it can go against you. I will show you how. But keep this in mind. Props, should they be used, should they not be used?
Maximum one.
Should they be used or should they not be used is the question.
Yes.
Should be used.
How many of you think that having a prop will get you more marks with the judges?
If used correctly.
I will come to that, Shiva, but here is the thing. Having a prop, you use a prop, first of all, you use it only when necessary. That is the first rule of using a prop. Use it only when necessary. Do not overdo it. By the way, your props are not physical props. Your jokes, your anecdotes, they are also props. Now consider the example of a joke. It on its own, the joke might be very good. It might make a lot of sense. It might make people, you know, peel into laughter. But if you try to deliberately incorporate it inside your speech, there is a high possibility that the joke will not work. And you have to make sure that your joke, whatever it is that you are trying to do, or whatever prop that you are trying to do, supplements your speech. It's not an add-on. For example, there was one speech and there was a person who was personified by a chair, and that chair was in the middle of the room, and the chair's name was Kevin. The person sitting on the chair was Kevin, and the speaker was trying to get life advice from Kevin. So he would ask Kevin, what do you think about it? And then he would stand behind the chair and say, I don't know what to think, or whatever was the response. There came a point in the speech, and this is a chair that will not fall down, but we very said that Kevin did not answer, because Kevin had, and he pushed the chair so that the chair fell down. Now that is an instance where a prop is necessary. The speaker himself said that that was an emotional point in his speech. He would find it very difficult to actually narrate it. That is where he used the props. So use props only when
necessary.
On to our next one. Body language. There is this research by Albert Mehrabian. He's a professor. Only 7% of what you say comes out of your mouth. 55% of it is body. 38% of it is vocal variety. Okay, Now, we can go into vocal vernacular. I am not an expert. You might have heard many things, pitch, timbre, this, that. I will tell you only about four things that you can easily manage. The first one is rate of speech. How fast you speak, how slow you speak, you can vary that pace. Volume. How low, how high you decide. However, when you are in a club contest, you have to be very careful, because in a club, there is a possibility, there is no mic, and your lowest volume might not be heard by the people sitting at the back. And there will inadvertently be a judge who might want to sit at the back. If they don't hear you, they will mark you down. And this has happened in the last division contest, international speech contest of Division A. A very promising speaker gave a wonderful speech at the area level. And my guess was that if he continued with the same form in the division, he would make it. But in the division, it was in a huge hall. There was no microphone. And his voice was just not there. I was sitting at the back and I was telling him, "Can't hear you." The person sitting next to me said that he's not wearing glasses, so he can't even look at you. His entire speech got messed up because of that. So regulate your volume. Third thing is pauses. 0.75 seconds. That is the time when your brain decides to respond to a question that is asked. So if you're asking rhetorical questions, you wait for 0.75 seconds. It's okay if you wait for more, but then keep in mind that people will respond, have your response ready. Do not keep your pause to less than 0.75 seconds. We tend to rush with our pauses. When we tend to rush with our pauses, that is where our speech starts falling apart. Keep your speech simple. Do not try to make it complicated. Do not try to be a Shashi Tharoor on stage. Do not try to use 15 words where only 5 will suffice, because you can use the other time to deliver more content that will add more meat to your speech. Write a 6-minute speech. What happened with me at the semi-final? I was told that timing would occur on a computer screen. I was actually looking for cards like these. The green card never came up. When I looked at the screen, it had already turned yellow. I did not know what had happened, whether it had just turned yellow or whether it had turned yellow a while ago, or whether it had turned yellow a while ago. Either way, I knew that I was in deep, deep, deep trouble. I finished my speech, 7 minutes, 30 seconds. 0.1 second more and I would have been disqualified on time. The learning that I've taken from there is that you write a 6-minute speech. Even if the audience responds, you still have 1.5 minutes left to play with. Define your own stage. So I define my stage as, 3 steps to this side, 3 steps to this side, and 3 steps to the back. That was my stage. On the international stage, you'll have a stage that is 50 feet long. 50 feet long, you don't want to walk all that distance. Why? Because remember that you broke your speech down into parts. You practiced each part. Each part has a specific number of steps that you can take. Take only that many number of steps. Do not go beyond that. Do not finish earlier than that. Your speech will go for a toss. Which is why you define your own stage within that stage. Practice anywhere and everywhere. I was practicing in my bathroom. My parents, my wife, my child were knocking on the door asking, why are you saying, why me, why me, why me? I was practicing while I was driving the car. My horn was my stage. And on my horn, I would place my finger. Okay, I'm at position 2. This is what I'm supposed to say. I'm at position 8. This is what I'm supposed to say. Not every time will you get a stage. So practice anywhere and everywhere. I practiced in Mukesh's office. I practiced inside a bathroom once. I practiced inside a restaurant. A lot of people looking at me. What is happening? But practice. And this is where I will also say, go to outdoor meetings. See when the elements are against you, how your speech sounds like. Because that will be a very good barometer of what your speech is going to be like. Stay positive. Sometimes things will not go your way. Sometimes someone like a Pankaj Prasad will come on stage. Doesn't mean that you will wish that, you know, he goes over time. You don't want to do that. Because Pankaj's speech is not in your control. The only person whose speech is in your control is yours. So do not silently wish, I wish Pankaj goes over time. Stay positive, focus on your performance. Own your speech. Suppose Shiv Priya gives me some advice and I take it and I mess up my speech on stage. Shivpriya is not to blame for it. I am to blame for it. Just as you would own your successes, learn to own your failures. Do not go back to the person and say that you messed up my speech. They did not. It was your decision. You were there on stage. They were not. This is, how many of you know about Richard P. Feynman? He was a Nobel laureate in physics. So in his celebrated works, the Feynman Lectures on Physics, he has said that if in a sudden cataclysm, all the information on Earth were to be destroyed, what is the one piece of information we could pass to the next generation so that they could rebuild the universe, so to speak? And he said, I believe that statement is the atomic hypothesis, that matter is comprised of atoms. Now, if in a sudden cataclysm, all knowledge related to Toastmasters was destroyed, what is the one thing that we could pass on to the next generation? And that answer is, get out of your club. You will never win a speech contest by staying in your club. I can guarantee you that. If you can, then you're probably God's gift to public speaking. And if you are God's gift to public speaking, you will still find me contesting against you. So get out of your club, try different audiences. That is why I went to the US early to try out the clubs there. I attended clubs in Chicago, Minneapolis, Grand Rapids, New Jersey, New York. Don't walk into applause or laughter. People are applauding. Do not walk into that. Don't offend anyone. Try your best not to offend anyone.
Mm-hmm.
Don't even think of below the belt humor. Don't back out. Just because Pankaj is contesting, I'm not going to contest. Don't do that. Don't plagiarize. I cannot emphasize the importance. In my club contest, a Toastmaster that I immensely respect plagiarized a speech. I was the first person to raise a protest. I raised a protest because if it gets caught at the club level, it's okay. But if it gets caught at the division level, it will bring a bad name to the club. That was my reason. At the division level, I saw a person plagiarizing, I raised a protest. And I have absolutely no shame in saying that I raised a protest. When you plagiarize, what is the worst that can happen to you? What is the worst you think that can happen to you?
Disqualification.
Disqualification is not the worst that is going to happen.
Your own confidence.
Understand this, there are judges who are marking you. They will mark you down on originality. Your first position might become second, your second might become third, your third might become no place at all. And if three or four judges combine together to decide that you don't deserve a place, well, your first place just went to no place. It doesn't matter whether you were disqualified or not. It doesn't matter whether the chief judge called you and said that, okay, we found your content to be original. The judges have already marked the ballot. Even though you are qualified, your speech has gone for a toss. You could have won first or second place. You're not going to win it because the judges have already decided. To end, there is this quote by Mark Brown that I want to call out. Your life tells a story, and there is someone out there who needs to hear it. You may think your story is not sensational, but it doesn't have to be sensational. It just has to be sincere. And if your audience can relate to you and your life experiences, chances are they will. Then you need to tell them what you've been through. Share your life, share your love, and share your message to the world. And on that note, I want you to share your message to the world. Remember that it starts with the message. And this is the part where you applaud and tell me that I'm a wonderful person.
Aww.